No, your eyes do not deceive you, folks. Beard is talking seafaring. In fact, the next few guides will follow suit as we discuss the levels of ocean, what lives at those levels, and much more. That said, one can't truly talk all things ocean without having covered how the heck one accesses the high seas first. Thus, from the brink comes another tab guide, everyone. From the self-explanatory to things far more involved than even I thought, let us break down the seafaring tab. And like most things seafaring, you will have to work to access the tab before even chalking over more resources for the stuff within it. All I'm saying is, seafaring is bloody expensive. The think tank is our only ticket to navigating the ocean, so get you one. Cause only then will the crafts become available. And while I can even accept the summary of the tab being simplified to, quote, a boat, some ways to move a boat, and other means to save a boat, there are some specifics that even surprised me in making this video. Not so much with our dumb wooden floating impressive nautical vessels here, but still. Did you know that overall player speed actually impacts just how far we can jump to and from our seafaring platforms? There is a maximum distance, of course. It's not like we're doing leaps and bounds here. But as you can see, even a simple walking cane can make quite the difference in that regard. Oh, but let us not forget one of the more useful uses for these so-called boats from day one. Boat bridges. Certainly expensive if we're talking long distance, but for quick branch connections, they can be literal lifesavers at times. Good stuff, and make use. All that said, what I truly wish to focus on for boats are leaks. Running ground into sea stacks, land itself, or even the complete edges of the world has a chance to cause a leak atop just straight up damage to our boats. And small leaks like this one here will cause the boat's health to drop additionally by 0.5 every second. Large leaks, on the other hand, drain 1 health from our boats per second, and yes, leaks do stack overall, which could be a problem. I find that larger leaks occur following impacts at higher speeds. However, be mindful of them at all times regardless. But now, one can actually repair their boat with various wood-like materials, such as boards, logs, twigs, you name it. Heck, even living logs work too. Each one restores various amounts of boat health. But do note that boat patches and trusty tape will stop leaks altogether, along with some of their general repair capabilities. But one last boat note before we move on. The plank. A mechanic that both makes sense and doesn't at the same time, and one I'm sure you forgot about yourself. One can extend the thing and completely abandon ship at any time they choose. And while you may think it's for when your boat's about to sink, there is literally zero difference between letting yourself go down with the ship or simply walking the plank before that happens. You still lose health and items, you still get wet, your stats will drop all the same, but just in one scenario, I guess, there's just a random floating boat on the ocean. So, alright, I guess. Moving on to the boat patch, something we literally just mentioned, so we won't be here long. Just amass yourself some stingers, or just use any of the hundreds you already have to make darn sure that you can save your butt out there on the water. You are gonna need lots of these things. But believe it or not, leaving behind an oar could also be a grave mistake, as oars are some of the most important seafaring items out there. At least in my opinion. Bring an oar, or what exactly? Well, oars have 500 uses, and allow us to propel our boats in whatever direction we desire. So, coupled with some other seafaring gizmos to come, oars allow for far greater control and much more manageable speeds. I'd advise you always have one at the ready. But be wary of spam clicking to go faster, because doing so will splash you and raise your wetness by 9 each failed rowing attempt. But not only that, it will deplete the durability of the oar itself drastically. Not good. But you know what is good, apparently? The driftwood ore. Functioning very similarly to the normal one, we won't discuss the alternative very long. But, contrary to what I've always believed, the driftwood ore is actually 1.66 times better at propelling our boats than the normal ones. Not the other way around. Huh. The more you know. Seems I need to show more respect, the driftwood. Ah. Anchor kit time. While I'll accept that the simpler explanation is right darn there in the description of the item, perhaps some specifics should still be mentioned. Oh, and this is where plenty of the more expensive crafts begin to come into play, so mind that as you play along yourself. Seafaring is a costly business, friends. Especially if you lose your boat, so have an anchor to make sure that doesn't frickin' happen. Also note how long it takes for anchors to deploy, as the timings could save your life. Anchors take about 2 seconds to drop and stop your boat, while in coastal and or brine waters, that jumps to about 5 seconds once you are in the swell ocean. And note too, that the time it takes to retract the anchor will also increase with the ocean depth. It will take roughly 7 seconds to drop and stop in the rough ocean, and lastly, about 9 seconds in hazardous waters. Although I really wouldn't worry about that last one. Might not seem too useful. However, any mistimings could really be costly. Just be careful the further you get out on the water, and the faster you happen to be going. Few last anchor notes here, though. Even with the anchor lowered, both a mast and or player rowing will still propel the boat in any direction, so use that knowledge as you please. As for me, I'd lower the anchor and raise the mast up, only then to use an oar to have total control over direction and speed, especially if I'm going to mine for salt at sea. Whomever is raising the anchor must remain close to it in order to finish the task, otherwise it's just going to be continuously resetting itself, which is important to know. And finally, hammering an anchor kit will result in a large leak forming on the boat, which could be disastrous if you're not prepared for that. So, why not just not hammer your anchors? Next up, the steering wheel kit. Alone, it is as simple as things come. It is a kit that contains a wheel that allows us to steer our boats. Wow. What a novel concept. However, they will be utterly useless without these puppies. Masts. No one is getting much done, let alone in a quick manner, without a mast or two. But how exactly do they work, and how do steering wheels actually factor into them? It's quite simple, actually. However, I still get folk who say they don't get it and always end up deploying their sails, and thus propelling their boats, right into land. So here's the deal. Upon initial placement, the sails will point in a random direction, yes, but place down a steering wheel, and suddenly you'll be the greatest captain alive. Do you see those little notches beneath the mast? The little different colored notches? Those indicate the direction the mast will propel the boat. So make sure they're pointed out towards the ocean before casting off and lowering the sails. Now, here's the deal about masts themselves. All in all, they deploy pretty much immediately, but take time to raise. That is, of course, unless you decide to click the mast once you see the words heave and then ho. Doing so will actually raise the sails far faster than normal, so make note there. That could really help in, you know, not crashing. But now, speed. Boats sit at a base speed of 0, obviously, and a mast will up that to 1.5 immediately. So with that knowledge, we can just assume that 2 masts will equal to 3 times a boat base speed, right? Wrong. While every additional mast will indeed increase speed overall, every additional mast loses 30% effectiveness overall, meaning your return to investment really isn't worth it past 3 to 4 sails, if you can even fit all of them to begin with. Thus enters our next craft, and a quote-unquote hidden one at that, the winged sail kit. This alternative mast will require you to not only find the incredibly elusive Malbatross, but vanquish it as well. For we need 2 of its blueprints to work towards this sail. It is a lot of work, and quite expensive. But is it worth it in the end? Well, for one thing, think of it as the opposite of a normal mass in the sense that the winged sail will raise faster but lower slower, with the heave-ho mechanic actually still being present, just opposite. For another thing, even but one winged sail is just about as fast as three normal ones. So if you tack on two of them suckers, you're gonna be zooming through the waters. Maybe even a bit too zoomy, if you know what I mean. But let us return to some of the more basic seafaring craft, shall we? Like the tin fishing bin here. The fishing bin can only be placed on boats, so be very mindful there. And it serves as a preservation means for ocean fish and lobsters. Not only will the tin stop them from spoiling altogether, it actually works to freshen up whatever happens to be inside along the way. Perfect for keeping them only for when you absolutely need them. The one downside, though, is that we can't actually stack the fish, so these 12 slots are all you get. Next up, some newer crafts like the deck illuminator here. It is essentially just a mast attachment to help save space on our floating platforms themselves, and we are all the better for it. Decent light, easily refuelable with just about anything, and does actually keep things quite spacious indeed. Very nice. And in a very similar vein comes the lightning conductor. Just a lightning rod mast attachment without the whole entire lightning rod. Trust me when I say that you are gonna want this one, especially come springtime. Heck, just get two masts up for Pete's sake to get both attachments working for ya. Another recent addition is that of the fire pump. A very easy craft, apart from, you know, the spittlefish, a mob that some of you might not even know about. But spittlefish are new ocean fish, found solely near seaweeds. For you see, they spawn in and are attracted to the green goo that the seaweeds produce on occasion. So grab a sea fishing rod and get to reeling them in. Now, the fire pumps themselves are very straightforward, because they're just ice fling-o-matics for boats, but cheaper and require manual pumping, essentially. Get too far from a pump and it's gonna stop flinging water globules every which way to Sunday. And by the way, now is a great time to mention that boats themselves are indeed flammable, so be very mindful there. It's not just what's on a boat that needs to be worried about. But two last crafts here. The first being the anchor sculpture sketch, which will, of course, lead to the anchor sculpture itself once placed within a potter's wheel and all that jazz. And remember, too, that one can use cut stone or moon glass as an alternative medium along the way. And finally, the pinch and winch. Yet another quote-unquote hidden seafaring craft locked behind level 2 of Pearl's Friendship and the Bottle Exchange. Yep, it's a whole bloody thing. But the pinch and winch will allow us to reach deep into the waters to pull out underwater salvageables like shell clusters, the celestial tribute dropped from the Crab King, and the much smaller ocean debris found randomly on the map, or even sunken treasure chests for when we've actually found Pearl already, yet have still continued to read her messages in a bottle to spawn X marks the spots. Is all of this interesting? Sure. I guess. Is any of it halfway needed or useful? Not even close. That said, and no, your ears are not broken. Seafaring has potential. It just isn't there yet, even after a year and a half of additions by Clay, but what have you. At least after today, we will be ready to sail the high seas a little easier when the time comes. Thanks for watching, everyone. Well wishes to all. I'll see ya at sea again soon, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye-bye.